we really started working in the area of cellular manipulation a few years ago when we realized some of the laser tools that we were using to measure chemicals could also be used to fabricate materials. What we've been working on is trying to make well-defined three-dimensional environments for culturing cells that might gain some of the advantages of isolating cells from their environment, allowing us better access to study them, to work toward materials that can be defined not only in bulk, but on increasingly smaller scales.
Here we have a bevo, or a longhorn, made out of bovine serum albumin. The actual size of this is less than 10 microns, which is less than half of a width of a human hair. It's truly microscopic.
I met Jason at a Wednesday meeting that we have for a bunch of the faculty. And so Jason sort of showed this really interesting technology, showed all these skulls that he could make that were micron sized, and he could draw beetles and he could draw all these sort of interesting things. And he was really looking for a biological application for this. So there's a lot of data out there right now that shows that bacteria actually act very differently when they're in groups as opposed to when they're by themselves. So they have this social behavior. It's called socio-microbiology.
So I collaborate with the Shear Laboratory, and basically we're studying bacterial cell-cell communication.
We normally do it like most microbiologists. You do experiments in test tubes, right? And you'll have 10 to the 8th, so, or 10 to the 9th cells. You may have a billion cells, right? And you take those billion cells and you average what they're all doing at once. We're able to actually go in and actually study very small populations of cells in very defined volumes and ask really important questions, I think.
The first time I went over to the Shear Laboratory, I got to see JODI fabricate some structures. And it was the coolest thing I ever saw, because you're looking at really small areas. I can say, hey JODI, give me a box that's about 10 microns by 10 microns by 8 microns tall, and she can make it for me.
Just like lobster traps, some of the bacteria will actually swim inside these three-dimensional enclosures. And once AIMEE catches a bacterium inside this little enclosure, what she does is she shuts the door on the enclosure, and she does that by raising the temperature and causes the gel to actually swell together so that the door shuts. And then what she can do is watch this one bacterium and actually try to understand its social and group behaviors.
They basically give us tiny, tiny boxes to put bacteria inside, and then we can examine the way the bacteria are behaving, and we can look at antibacterial resistance inside of these small traps, which is something that you can't do in batch culture in a giant flask.
Biofilms, which are aggregates of bacterial cells, like to attach and adhere to surfaces, and they are fouling on medical implant devices.
This is really important because biofilms are thought to be about 60% of all infections in the hospital are supposed to be biofilm derived.
So what I'm trying to do is not let bacteria attach to a surface. To use these types of designs to line the inside of a catheter, for instance, or other medical implant device.
One definition of a smart material are materials that respond to their environment in definable ways. If I want to have a material that changes its size or shape in response to a particular chemical that might be present, that could be of a lot of use. One of the real holy grails is being able to guide two nerve cells to hook up in a way that they might regain functionality.
So when nerves are damaged now, what most surgeons like to use is just taking a piece of nerve tissue from somewhere else in your body and grafting it. And the drawbacks to that are you lose function, it's more costly, it's more risk to the patient because it's additional surgeries.
What we want to be able to do is create an implant that will encourage that nerve to regrow.
Our ultimate goal is to create these types of structures so that we can guide individual neurons along a precise path. So we can provide chemical guidance as well as topographical guidance, and that could facilitate reconnecting these damaged nerves. It does combine two areas of expertise, and there's no way that my lab could be the experts in what we're experts in as well as doing what Jason does.
It's genuinely two techniques from two different labs. If there's an experiment that I'm having trouble with, I can go ask Christine for her perspectives on, you know, what I might do to fix this problem. I can go ask Jason in chemistry what are his perspectives, and they will be completely different. I don't want to just do one subject. I'm really interested in several subjects. I mean, that's first of all the reason why I picked biomedical engineering. It's already a cross between biology and engineering.
Scientists from different fields, maybe surprisingly, are kind of like people from different nations, and they speak in different tongues. And learning to communicate with each other is one of the big obstacles. By getting graduate students involved in this early in their career, they learn to speak in these multiple languages and to cross these barriers, and I think are now primed in their careers to make much bigger contributions. Mm-hmm.